Good morning, Bethesda House of Mercy. Good morning.
Good morning.
God is so good,
yeah.
Isn't he?
Amen.
Let's stand and worship the Lord this morning. Did you feel the mountains tremble? Did you hear the oceans roar? When the people rose to sing of Jesus Christ the risen one. Did you feel the people tremble? Did you hear the singers roar? When the lost began to sing of Jesus Christ the Saving One. And we can see that God, you're moving a mighty river through the nations, and young and old will turn to Jesus. The risen Lord.
lift up your voice, fall on your knees, all hail the reigning King of Kings. Nations and tribes, rulers and lords, come in thy Lord. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, how great.
Lord a shout of praise. Tell him how great he is to you. Tell him how great he is to you. He is great. My God is good. My God is great. Make it personal. My God is great. He is great. He does great things for me. He watches over me. He loves me. He corrects me. He encourages me. And he's your God too. Amen. He does that for us because he loves us. When our children act up, we correct them because we love them and we want them to do good. Same thing with our Heavenly Father. He loves us. We have an opportunity to give this morning of tithes and offerings. And I pray that you've already made that ready before you got here. We gather, and I'm glad we do, gather on Sunday mornings to worship our Lord and our Savior and get to come together and fellowship and encourage one another. It starts when we come in the door. And if you're online watching, come and look and see. You'll see how each one's encouraging each other and glad and happy to see each other. But we come to worship the Lord, and we can worship him in giving. And Jesus taught us a lot in giving all through the scriptures. When he was with the teaching, and he was before they fed the 5,000, and they were hungry. They didn't know what to do. Well, what do you have? They have some bread, a little bit of bread and some fish. Well, have them to sit down, and he break that and blessed that and fed them. Give what you have. He also showed us in the scriptures with the widow that was given. You know, on the other people were watching, the Sadducees and Pharisees were watching how people were giving and kind of measuring, oh, well, they give this much and they give that, but she given a couple of coins, it said. And that's all she had. That's what she had to live on. But he teaches us to give in order to receive. And he goes on, the scripture goes on and says that when we give from the right heart, and that's what we want, be led by the Spirit. Amen? Led by his Spirit. Practice a life of giving. I thought about, we've heard several messages of back to the basics. And I thought about that this past week or two. When we taught our children, you gave them money to go to Sunday school at that day. You made sure they had monies to. When I brought my granddaughter to the VBS, she wanted to give the coins and not the bills. So that's what was important to her, the coins. I didn't care. You can do that. But we taught them to give at a little age. And you taught them to start paying tithes. Because you want them to live out a good life, a life beyond you, practicing, worshiping the Lord and giving. And my girls still do that today. So we need to teach that to our children in our homes. They're never too little. They're never too little to start those basic things with them, teaching them. You know, as they grow, you teach them the worth of what value money is, because at first they don't know, they don't have an idea, but you teach them those things. So teach that in your home when you're with your family sitting down. Teach them to give. Jesus wants us to give. He wants us to share what we have with others, but he also wants us to give, to obey him. Father, we thank you this morning that we can come together on this day and worship the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, our God, our Savior. We are so thankful for you, Lord, what you're doing in our lives. Help us to be givers, Lord. Be generous givers. Not to worry about what we're going to have or not have, but you will supply that. Many times you told them, go out with nothing. Don't take nothing. But it'll all be supplied. So, Father, we thank you for the tithe today that you have provided. We thank you for being able to give offerings, and we bless you and ask your blessings over this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Hold on to your seats, folks. We've got a lot of announcements today. That's a good thing, right? That means the Lord's doing a lot of things. He's doing a lot of things. Sorry I missed you guys last week. I was in the great state of Missouri, Sedalia, Missouri. I missed church Sunday, and I missed my first church group. Missed them dearly. But the brother I was riding with in the truck, he was a solid Christian man, and we had church in that truck every day. We had prayer time. We had a lot of talks about the Lord and what our churches do and what was going on. So even though I wasn't here, I had a blessed week with my friend, and I got to know another brother in the Lord, and now we're communicating through text message and phone calls, and it was a blessing. But we have a lot of announcements, so get ready. It's in your bulletin. If you don't have a bulletin, get one when you come in. You can see the greeters. The announcements are in the pamphlets. That way, you when you leave here, you got them. You just don't hear it, but you can read it. So, June 24th, when is that? Tomorrow, that's right. Tomorrow we're doing Feeding America at 5:30 at 300 Peterson Drive. Come be a part of that. If you've done that before, if you have done Feeding America, raise your hand. If you've been there and you've done it, all right, most of the church. So if you haven't done it, 5:30, 300 Peterson Lane, come be a part of helping our community. June 29th, we got a Peru trip car wash. Come support our folks that are going to Peru for that mission. It is needed financially. Let's support that team and pray for them while we can, right? Pray for them and financially support that. It's by donation only, so we're not charging $20 a car. You come in and you pray about that, and there's times that Beth has prayed, and she's called me, what are we giving to the car wash? And I'm like, I don't know. You're the one getting the wash. You pray about it. Not being mean, but I'm on the road, and I'm like, and then she'll call and she'll say, well, I gave this amount. And I'm like, great. And I'll get home and the car's not even washed. I didn't make it, but can you send the money in? I'm like, no problem. So, you know, you don't even have to get your car washed to donate, as my wife did. So praise the Lord for that. You can sign up in the lobby if you want to help volunteer to wash the cars. You can never have too many people at a car wash. We all know it's hot and not always fun and exciting. So come volunteer and make it exciting. How's that? Amen? All right. All right, here we go. June 30th, following the service, will be a children's ministry food fundraiser. Fundraising dinner. How many of you know the children are important? How many of y'all know that leadership in this church won't be here forever? Right? So who's the next generation? Every generation is going to rise up. Somebody's going to rise up. Let's pour into that generation. They deserve it. July 7th, corporate prayer. Come out. 5 o'clock. Yeah. Amen. July 11th. This is different, guys. Some of y'all might not have never heard of this, but do you ever see the flag? Right? You ever see that during service? That's flag ministry. And we're going to have training for that. Amen. You can clap. It's good. There's something about it. There's something about it. If you haven't seen Alexa do it, I'm telling you, and Miss Sarita do it, and there's other people that's done it. I'm telling you, there is something behind that. I've heard people say, oh, that flag stuff's distracting. Well, guess what? You're not worshiping. Yeah. Amen? And so if you want to be a part of learning about the flag ministry, being trained in that, come to that class, because it's a 6-week training. And I think I can say, if you don't know what it is, come see Miss Sarita about that, Pastor Sarita, and she can inform you about that. There's a lot to it, and it's very informational. Let her fill you in on some of that. But I'm telling you, that's a cool thing, and it's something that there's a declaration with that comes with that. So sign-up sheet is in the lobby, so if you're interested, sign up at 6-week class. That's not very long. It's not very long at all. July 14th, Bethesda's informational class. Come out and see what Bethesda's all about. It'll be at 4 o'clock. That also sign-up sheet is in the lobby. So if you want to come see what we're about, do the informational class, come see us at 4 o'clock, July 14th. This is something new. I told you there's a lot of announcements, but this is new. We have some new things going. July 20th, the Young Adult Morning Devotional. I believe it's going to be led by Anthony and Heather, right? Donuts and coffee will be served at 7:30 a.m. Early bird, Heather, I hear you. at Heather and Anthony's house. That's a Saturday morning. You know, a lot of us sleep in or whatnot. Young adults, come out. They're going to set something up, and they're going to have, it's not just going to be random stuff, right? It's going to be a challenging thing for you guys to be a part of. There's going to be some structure to it that enables you to grow and mature in the Lord. And I think that's going to be great. So if you're a young adult, you know a young adult, plug them in Saturday morning. July 20th, 7:30, donuts and coffee. August 13th, Impact School of Ministry, the classes begin for the 24-25 year. The first class is the Gospel of John. Make sure you register today to reserve your seat. We also have a sign-up sheet that's outside. Sign up, learn and grow. That's all the announcements I have, folks. If we can rise to our feet, I must begin to meet and greet. Amen.
Mountain you won't shadow you won't hide up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh, there's no shadow you won't hide up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
Do you not know that the power of God is manifesting right now? He's moving right now. He's seeking right now. He's breaking down walls right now. He's shattering strongholds right now. He's coming after you. Even before you go after Him, He's coming after you. In your life right now, there's nothing too great for God. There is no power too powerful for God. God is the great I am, and He is the conqueror. He's the soon coming King. He's the one that breaks down every barrier in your life. Do we understand what we're singing about? Is it just words? Do you understand what He's saying? He's going to knock down walls. He's going to tear down lies. Some of you are believing lies about yourself. I want you to know the devil's a liar. He's the father of lies. He's there to try to deceive you. He's there to try to trap you. He's there to try to steal from us what God has for us. But God is not sitting there while we are entangled. God is chasing after you. Chasing after us. you believe it? Well, I want you to know something today. I declare in the name of Jesus, this is the day that strongholds will be broken off. This is a day when walls will be torn down. This is a day when traps of the enemy will be revealed. This is the day and the hour that you can leave here free in Jesus' name. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Luke chapter 4:18 says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance, to preach deliverance to those who are captives, and the recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed. There is an oppression of the enemy upon God's people in this day and time that we live in. But I want you to know the same God, the same Lord, the same Jesus that came to this earth to fulfill this scripture is the same Jesus that's here in this place right now to do the very same things that he said he was going to do then. Brokenhearted, oppressed, to deliver. Amen. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. There's no variableness in him. There's no shadow of turning in him. He is the rock on which I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. But on Christ, who we put our faith in, our hope in, he is the same right now as he was when he walked on this earth. Do you not sense his glory and his presence? Last week I began to talk about how the enemy has inflicted us. You can be seated, unless you want to stand up for the next hour. How the enemy has succeeded in causing great wounds and afflictions, even in the saints of God. We already know, don't we? People that don't have Jesus are in bondage. Right? We already know that people do not have Jesus are afflicted. We already understand that people without Christ have emotional issues. They are entrapped, whether they realize it or not. Why? Because the Bible says you can't serve two masters. You can only serve the one or the other. It's either Jesus or it's the enemy. Now, you may not be walking around today saying, I worship the devil, but I want you to know Jesus said to the scribes and Pharisees, if you would have believed on me like Abraham did, then you would be praising me right now. But because you are of your father, the devil. How many of you know they did not like that comment? They didn't have no clue. They didn't think they were of their father, the devil. But the simple fact is that we're not all, everybody in this world is not children of God. Hello? Everybody out there, they're not children of God. You're either a child of the king because you believed and now follow him. Believing's not enough. You can believe in God and still be lost. Oh, I believe. Yeah, well, the devils in hell believe too. But they're not going to heaven because the evidence of believing is the walk. It's the after part. It's what happens after I say I believe. It's this easy believism that we have that everybody wants to think that they are of the same God. Even preachers today preach and teach a lot that we all serve the same God. We just don't have the same understanding. I want you to know that if somebody out here is worshiping God, but they're not celebrating and worshiping Jesus Christ, his son, they are not worshiping and serving the same God. Bondage. Even though we know in the world people are in trouble, I don't believe we recognize and realize just how much in trouble the church is. Jesus declares this breaking off of the things that held people captive was what he was sent here and anointed for, to bring back into place the kingdom of God, to reestablish the authority and the power of the kingdom, to give people the power to walk in rightness. How many of you want to walk in rightness? The righteousness of God we want to walk in. People today have emotional wounds. We talked last week about how those emotional wounds and things in people's lives started when they were living at home. Some people have emotional wounds that were inflicted upon them by relatives. Anybody have an emotional wound that was inflicted upon you by a relative? People have physical, mental, verbal, or sexual abuse. They have a feeling of abandonment. Then we deal with our own sin, broken relationships, major disappointments in our lives. Some people have gone through nasty divorces. Just a general, how many of you know there's just some people out here, we have them in our families, we have them where we work at, we have them as we come into contact with people on a daily basis. Some people are just flat out mean, nasty. This seems like for no reason at all, they just got nastiness all over them. Even kids can be very mean at times. Anybody's kid in here ever been bullied? Sometimes our kids are the bullies. Kids are mean. Moral failures, adultery, abortion, etc. All of these things the enemy has used to establish wounds and hurts in people's lives. Maybe sometimes as we walk this out, a lot of times we're not aware of the fact of how affected we are by these things that have come upon us in our lives. I want you to know, I really believe this. I believe at new birth, I am as free as I am ever going to be. Hello? Whom the Son has set free is free indeed. And I can remember the night that I gave my heart to the Lord. I can remember after being in that altar for that length of time, coming up out of there, by the time I got up to go back to my seat, three quarters of the church had already gone home, and I sat back down on the second row, and I can remember taking a deep breath and thinking to myself, wow, I have never felt like this before. The freedom was unbelievable. The deliverance, all the things that had held me captive, the wounds, the hurts, the voices, and all the elements that had been in my life, I felt like, man, I was at liberty. I could breathe. That was wonderful. And then I got up and walked out, started living my life. And I want you to know something. We find ourselves today in some forms of captivity, not because Jesus is lesser, not because his blood is still not powerful, not because the Holy Spirit is not working or wants to work in us, but we then have taken back on the things in this life that we really should not have picked back up. Come on. Anger, bitterness, hate, sometimes even violence. We repeat the things that have happened to us. You know that most people that are abusers were abused themselves? It's facts. Shame, guilt. How many of you have issues sometimes with shame? Well, four of you are honest today. The rest of us can repent in a minute. Shame, guilt. When you raise your hand up when I'm speaking, you know what I know? I know you're listening to me. You're hearing me. How many of you know we have ears to hear what the Spirit is speaking to the church? I'm going to tell you what. You need to open your ears up this morning because the Holy Spirit wants to speak to us. We are no longer going to sit stuck in the muck. Shame, guilt. Unworthiness, self-condemnation, no confidence, self-esteem, loneliness, withdrawn, very few friends or relationships because of our wounds, unable to respond to others properly. We have eating disorders. We're afraid to show love because we have to protect ourselves. Inability to trust others. Misconceptions about God. We don't know who he really is. We have father issues. Come on. A deep sense a lot of times, maybe not all the time. How many of you know this isn't all the time or else we'd go jump off the bridge? But deep senses of despair. Depression, addictions. I'm preaching to Bethesda, not Elizabethtown. Did you hear what I said? Addictions, alcohol, drugs, sex. Even at times, suicidal tendencies. These things exalt themselves above the knowledge of God. Because people that have Jesus should not have despair. People that have Jesus shouldn't be finding themselves wallowing in these things. But the reason that we do is because we have embraced them back into that once Jesus set us free from. In the class I teach on Tuesday night, discipleship class one, there's somebody in that class that tells me, man, I go really fast. So you notice how I'm speaking slower today because I want us to get this. I really believe Jesus is getting ready, the Holy Spirit's getting ready to break off some strongholds. We are to bring every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. But in order to bring every thought captive, we have to have the power of the Word working in us. If you do not know the book, you cannot take false lies or half-truths captive. I was proud to hear from our campers this week, our teenagers and stuff, because some things were said that weren't exactly biblical, and our teenagers came back and said, wait a minute, that's not true, is it? You know why our teenagers went and said, that's not true, is it? Is because they have been taught and they know the truth. The truth, we know the truth, but sometimes we don't walk in it. We've got knowledge. How many messages have you heard? How many times has somebody preached to you? Have you ever sat and asked yourself, man, with as much that I have heard and known, I should be way further than what I am? Huh? Am I the only one that looks in the mirror and says, oh my goodness, dude, you've been serving God since you were 18 years old. You're 64 now. You should be a lot further down the road. But just because I've heard it, don't mean I own it. Doesn't mean that I am allowing it to work in me. It's Christ in me, the hope of glory. It's putting on the Lord Jesus Christ, clothing myself in the righteousness of God, allowing the truth of God's word to embrace me and to fill me and to overflow in me, allowing myself that truth of God's word that gives me the strength and the power to lay aside every lie, every weight, every sin that does so easily beset me. It's putting on Jesus, the author and the finisher of my faith. Strongholds are a mindset impregnated with hopelessness that causes us to accept as unchangeable something we know is contrary to the will of God. Did you hear that? Strongholds are mindsets that have been impregnated with hopelessness that causes us to accept as unchangeable something we know is contrary to the will of God. Matter of fact, we get in this frame of mind so much that we start trying to make excuses as though what we understand is really not the will of God, but we still have it anyway. As though that will help us to walk out what we're supposed to walk out. How many of you know that that's not what God wants? We have taught in this church that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Every person in here has been designed by God. Think about that. Would you let that soak in for a minute? We have been designed by God. The Bible says that while we were in our mother's womb, He knew us. That before we even had a name, He named me and called me by mine. I want you to know, He knew my name was going to be Jerry before my parents ever even got together. If you let some of that sink in, man, you're going to start to realize, man, I'm serving a God Almighty, a sovereign God, a powerful God, a God that nothing is impossible with. We sit around sometimes and walk out our life as though we believe some things are impossible. And some things are impossible for me, but my faith is not in me. My faith is in the one who nothing is impossible with. He has all power. He has all authority. There's no demon in hell that can contend with Him. I have been fearfully and wonderfully made. He has designed me for who I am and what I am to do. He knew my destiny before I was ever here. And He says the work that He started in me, He is faithful. How many of you know God was faithful before you were faithful? How many of you know God's faithful now when you're not faithful? When you're not faithful, God doesn't abandon you. God doesn't throw you under the bus. God doesn't kick you out. Like what people like to say today, well, if you sin, then you're going to go to hell if you don't. Listen, I want you to know, I've been bought with the blood of Jesus Christ. His grace is not that weak. His grace is powerful. And what He started in me, He will finish. I will not be lost. I'm going all the way to the end. There's a perseverance. There's a perseverance for the saints. I don't go to sleep at night even when I fail thinking I'm going to hell. Amen. Don't let nobody tell you. Don't let no preacher. Don't let no church tell you that. You know why the devil wants us to speak that? Because he wants us to live in an insecurity. Huh? Man, I tell you what, I don't believe my kids ever went to bed one night in their lives that they didn't know their mom and I loved them. Huh? And I want you to know, God doesn't want you to go to bed not one night thinking, uh-oh, I might not wake up tomorrow. I might be in hell. If you've been born again from above, because he says we're born again, not of the will of man. Come on. Not of the will of man, but we are born again because of the will of God. He redeemed me. He changed my life. It wasn't nothing that I did in order to be saved. I sure in the world can't do nothing to stay that way. Everybody's losing out because they fall short or fail, every single one of us are going to hell. Hello? You can't sit there today and say that you have no sin. Come July 8th, I'm going to be able to see all the way in the back. At least out of one eye. Can't say it. If you have doubt, you have sin. If you have fear, you have sin. If you have anxiety, you have sin. Whatsoever is not of faith is sin. But you know what? We don't repent. Come on. You say, well, but if I sin, I need to repent. We don't repent over anxiety. We embrace it. We don't pray over unbelief. We count it as common. It's just the way it is, Pastor Jerry. Life causes you to embrace those things. Not if you're in the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God walks by a different governor. The kingdom of God walks by a different rule. The kingdom of God walks by a different mindset. The kingdom of God walks by a mindset that God has set me free. I will not embrace that. Oh, you're coming against me. You're coming against me with anxiety. But God says, be anxious for nothing. But this is the will of God in Christ Jesus, that you have peace. I got my phone in my pocket, and I don't even know what time it is. Do you think I care? it just was feeling a little tight on this pocket. It's the only reason I thought about it. God, help us. Help me to be free. I want to breathe him in and exhale. Amen. I want to walk in the peace that passes understanding. But in order for us to do that, we have to understand he's given us weapons that we can have, that we can live that way. You know what we have to first do? He says, if a person is going to come after me, they must first believe that I am. And that I am a rewarder of those who diligently seek me. But one of the weapons that we have understand is we've got to believe that Jesus really desires to heal and mend up and heal up our wounds. The Bible says that it is our faith that overcomes the world. Therefore, our healing process to begin in our lives, we must believe that Jesus really desires to heal us and make us whole. Why? So we can be examples to those that are around us. This world is crumbling around us. Suicide rates are sky high. Drug overdoses are sky high. Alcoholism is sky high. Everything in the world that we think of that brings people's lives crashing down is at an all-time high. Why? Because the enemy, he's moving in their midst. They don't know it, but he's scheming and he's taking them and deceiving them into believing a lie. They think escaping this life takes them to something better.
The only thing that takes you to something better is when you are bought with the blood of Jesus Christ. The problem is we're still too alive. We think we belong to ourselves. Come on. We think we're the caretakers, are the owners. But the Bible tells me I was bought with a price. My life is not my own. I belong to the Lord. If I belong to the Lord, then who is it that I should have faith in that's going to see me through? The Lord's not going to allow me to go under, but I have to trust him. Mark 2:17 says, when Jesus heard it, he said to them, those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick, I did not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Listen, let me tell you something. Do not go around saying that you are a sinner. God, you are a sinner saved by grace. You're a sinner. I am a sinner. I have been saved by grace, but I am not a sinner. Did you hear me? I once was lost, but now I'm found. I once was blind, but now I see. I once was a sinner, a practicing pervert, a practicing liar, a practicing adulterer, a practicing fornicator. I was living for the devil, but now I'm a sin, but I'm not a practicing sinner. I've been washed in the blood of Jesus Christ. What I once was, I am no more. Don't use that terminology. Trying to be humble. What I once was. Because you know what? When God looks at you, let's just say, for example, you were in the foyer this morning before church ever started. Let's just say that it was Logan and Caden and Logan was, they were talking, and let's just say that Logan got this bright idea to tell a story to Caden, and he's in the midst of this story, and da-da-da-da-da, and he starts telling the story, but in his mind, he's making the story way bigger than what it was. He's making himself out to be a superhero. He's making himself out to be the savior of whatever the situation was, when really and truthfully, he was just over here in the corner leaning against a post while other people were dealing with whatever was going on. But he's taking full credit of it. What did he just do? He fabricated something. He lied. He lied. He sinned. But if he's been born again, he's not a sinner, because when God looks at him, God does not look at that. God looks beyond that. Why? Because that life, that soul, that person is covered, listen, covered in the blood of Jesus. Does he need to give account for what he just did? Does he need to repent for what he just did? Will what he just did separate him from the activity of the Spirit in his life? Absolutely. He needs to make it right with God, make it right with Caden, and he needs to get things right. I'm not telling us that we ought to walk and say, well, I'm not a sinner no more. I don't have to repent. No, we live a life of repentance because we're not sinners anymore. We're followers of Jesus. I'm a child of God that still falls short of the glory of God, but I am not what I was. Everybody in this building should have shouted over that. Once I was sick, but now he's healed me. Hebrews 4, 14 through 16 says, seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. What's he saying there? Listen, why do we have to come before the throne of grace if we don't ever have any issues? We have issues and we need grace because we're having these problems and these trials and these difficulties. What he's saying though is the one who gives mercy and grace was tempted just like you. He understands what you're going through, but he himself did not sin or fail. And so when we do, we go to him because we know his mercy and his grace endures forever. Thank you, Lord. God is in the business of taking people that are broken and wounded and hurt and healing them and putting them back together again and making them what he, and developing them and make them what he wants them to be. Aren't you glad that the Lord is making you what he wants you to be? If I submit to him. The story of Mary Magdalene is a great example of the fact that Jesus can take a life that everybody thinks is worthless and no good and not worth time. Jesus can take a life, a prostitute, somebody who was abused and used by men, somebody who had demons in her life, and Jesus can go and he can cast those spirits out. He can remove those spirits and cause somebody to stand there in their right mind, cleansed and washed, and have a successful, rewarding life. Jesus is more than enough. All we have to do is acknowledge and confess our wounds. Stop trying to smooth them over with butter. Yeah. Wounds and hurts and things of that nature will not go away until we learn to confess those things and acknowledge them. Psalm 62, 5 through 8 says, my soul waits silently for God alone, for my expectation is from him. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be moved. In God is my salvation. Salvation not in myself. In God is my salvation and my glory. The rock of my strength and my refuge is in God. Trust in him at all times. You people, pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. Selah. Woo! Hallelujah. Man, we ought to jump up and down. We ought to rejoice. Somebody ought to get excited. God is my refuge. God is my strength. Even when I am weak, he is strong. Even when it's going bad, God will turn what the enemy means for my bad. He'll turn it around for my good. Woo! Thank you, Lord. Oh, man, don't get too excited here. You gotta. Even though I rehearse this 150 times a week, I still have to look because I'm getting older. Most of the time, almost all the time, listen, we have been programmed to deal with the symptoms. I'm going to tell you what, this is some truth. If you're listening, we've been trained to deal with symptoms, not the root. The root stays, and we deal with the symptom. Well, I have a headache. We have pain in that headache, but we deal with the pain, not the cause. We are no different. We are no different. We are no different in the spiritual sense. We deal with symptoms and not the cause. Listen, the Bible says we're drawn away by our own lust. He didn't say the problem was the symptom, the device. The problem is the lust. But even not the lust is the finality of it. He says, but that lust, that desire, when it is conceived. Other words, we're dealing with the symptoms, and so we have this lust thing, this desire for whatever it is, this hunger for whatever it is. When that is conceived in us, then because of the conception or the birth of it, it brings forth sin. And sin brings forth death, separation. Did you hear me? Separation. We use that death. Well, there I am. I'm no longer born again. I'm no longer a Christian. He says it right there. Sin brought forth death. No, sin brought forth separation. At the moments of my sin, I am separated from the fellowship of God. And the only response that's going to be heard from me until I deal with what's really going on is, Father, forgive me. But what do I need to look at? I need to look at the root. We have to have the ability to examine ourselves to discern the root of what's going on. Whether it's disobedience on our own part, whether it's other people's sins, whether it's evil spirits, or whether it's circumstances. How many of you know the enemy uses people and circumstances? The circumstances of my life want to hold me in captivity. The circumstances of my life want to keep me in bondage. The circumstances of a broken home, no father, no life, nobody in my life like that, that I really need it for most of my life. The enemy wants to hold me in captivity to that. But when I look at the root cause that's there, the sin, the destruction, the lack of God's presence, I go to God, I deal with a root and I cast that root out. I break that root off, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. It's not in my own strength. In myself, I can do nothing. In myself, I can do nothing. God wants to heal us. Psalms 38, 4 and 5 says, for my iniquities have gone over my head like a heavy burden. They are too heavy for me. My wounds are foul and festering because of my foolishness. But Acts 3, 19 says, repent. Repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, so that times... How many people need a refreshing? So that times of refreshing will come from the presence of the Lord. 2 Corinthians 7, 10, 11 says, for godly sorrow produces repentance to salvation, not to be regretted, but the sorrow of the world produces death. For observe this very thing, that you sorrowed in a godly manner. What diligence it produced in you. What cleaning of yourselves. What indignation, what fear, what vehement desire, what zeal, what vindication. In all things you proved yourself to be clear in this matter. Why? Because I had not worldly sorrow, not worldly sorrow, but godly sorrow. Godly sorrow brought me to repentance. Not justification of my deeds. Godly sorrow brings you to broken heart repentance. In order to maintain our healing and our deliverance, listen, we here at this church believe in deliverance. We believe in deliverance. But I don't believe you have to go to a specified deliverance ministry. Huh? And go through the chart of your existence. and identify all of your family curses. I want you to know the only reason something from your family is affecting you is because when you left this spot, you took it back. Hello? It's not because you got some overwhelming family curse hanging over you. Jesus Christ is the curse breaker, the curse healer, the curse deliverer. He's the one that's more than enough. If I'm sitting here having an issue that my forefathers had, it's because I came back and embraced it. But at the time that I was born again and filled with God's Spirit, the things in my past, the things in my family's history, God broke them off and set me free. Don't sit around and say, well, the reason I am the way I am because my great-great-grandfather was a pervert. Dumb. My great-great-grandfather might have been a pervert. I don't know if he was or not, but I know this. Jerry Westerfield, if I'm a pervert, isn't because of my great-great-grandfather. It's because Jerry Westerfield picked up perversion. And I didn't lie when I said I'd stay up here this long. Tell the truth, right? The stronghold is destroyed as we purpose to fulfill all obedience. Obedience. Listen, folks. Listen. We're in the mess we're in right now because we're not obedient. You can challenge me. You can come and say, I don't believe that. But look, listen. You know what I'm going to say to you, don't you? What am I going to say? What's the book say? What's the book say? Man, the book says it's not about you saying I believe. It's about you being obedient. Hello? It's about obeying the book. It's not about obeying your idea of the book. It's not obeying the traditions of men. It's not obeying a church tradition or the church of God of prophecy tradition. That's not where it's going to be at. How it's going to happen is through the obedience of the Lord Jesus Christ, submitting myself to Him and acknowledging I no longer belong to myself, I belong to you. If He is my King, my first desire is to obey Him. Can you throw, I don't think I gave it to you. Can you throw 2 Corinthians 10:5 up for me? Big. Oh, man. Listen, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. How am I going to break the stronghold? How am I going to get to the root? I've got to take into captivity every false lie, every half-truth, everything that's been twisted, and I got to bring it under subjection to the truth and obey it. If something comes across my path that I wasn't taught or didn't believe, what am I supposed to do? Keep believing what my grandfather said or believe the book? I love my grandfather, but he didn't know everything. You loved your parents, maybe. Some of you have a great history here of parents who were involved in ministry. I think about the Spainhowers. What a ministry, what a legacy they had of a mom and dad who loved Jesus and followed after Jesus. But I'm going to tell you what, the Spainhower family is not obligated to follow after what their dad said. They're there to see what he did and praise God for it. But my responsibility is to do what the book says, even if it's contrary to what they said. That's why Jesus said you're going to have to hate your father, your mother, your sister, your brother, your wife, your husband, your own children, and most importantly, your own life, because you have to put me before all that. You have to serve me and not man. God wants us to be healed. I want to tell you something about obedience here. How many of you want to be healed today? How many of you want to be set free today? You want everything broken off your life today. You want to leave here. You want to leave here different than you came, in Jesus' name. You don't want to be bound, afflicted, or tormented, sick or lame. You want to walk out of here free, whole. Amen? That's what we're after. That's what we want. Well, I'm going to tell you what. Listen, all these hurts, all these wounds, all these things that happened in your life, if you want to be free from those things, then what you have to do is you have to forgive. Remember, we talked about obedience. God's word's telling us, Matthew 6:15, but if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Maybe you're walking around in here today bound, tormented, sick, or lame because you have unforgiveness in your heart. Maybe you're walking around in here today feeling unworthy, feeling shame, feeling guilt, not knowing why can I get rid of these things, God? But you're sitting there holding into bondage that person, those people, those circumstances that caused you the problem to begin with. You carry them around with you in a cage, and every once in a while you take them out and you slap them across their face and you give them the what for. Then you put them back in there and you go on about your business. Why? Because it makes you feel comfortable. I've got somebody to hate for what I'm going through. Well, I'm telling you right now, listen, don't do that. Open up the door on the cage and let that person go. Let those circumstances go. Get rid of it. But Pastor Jerry, you don't understand. They hurt me over and over and over again. And Peter came to Jesus in Matthew 18:21, and he said, Master, how many times? Woo! How many times do I forgive? And Jesus said, 70 times 7. Now, some of y'all went to school and don't know what 70 times 7 is. I'm going to help you. 490 times. Well, Pastor Jerry, I've forgiven them 492. So that's enough. I don't have to forgive them anymore. Yes, you do. 7 means perfection. Jesus was stating to them, listen, every single time, even if it's 499, you forgive. Why? Because if you don't forgive, if you don't let them out of the cage, if you don't let them out of bondage, you're not going to be forgiven yourself. Woo! Colossians 3, 12 through 14 says, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies. Look in the mirror and ask yourself, is this me, Lord? Because this is what he says the elect of God is. Do you know why that's important? To be able to identify with the elect of God? You know why it's important? Because God says in his word, not one of the elect will be lost. That's why he tells me to make sure of my salvation. How do I do that, God? Well, here he says, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies. Did you notice that? He didn't say to you, reach inside and pull them out. He said, put on. That means that I have to put on Christ every day. Put on tender mercies, kindness. Oh, here's a big one. humbleness of mind. Wow, humbleness of mind. In other words, stop thinking more highly of yourself than you ought to think. Stop walking around like you're some spiritual giant. Stop walking around like you're better than everybody else, like you hear more than everybody else, like you hear clearer than everybody else. Stop walking around like that. Walk around in the humbleness of mind. Without you, Jesus, I'm nothing. Meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another. Bearing with one another. Man, do you have to bear with me? I see people over here nodding their heads. I'm going to look over here now. Rats. Bearing with one another. Listen, we bear with one another, but he didn't stop there. He says, and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against whoever, against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. But above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. Man, I could read so many more scriptures. Evil spirits are plaguing the church. Do you know that you can have an evil spirit that's tormenting you? 1 Peter 5:8 says, be sober, be vigilant. Why? Because your adversary, the devil, the spirits that are now at work within this place, they walk about like a roaring lion, seeking whom they may devour. But yet Ephesians 6:10 tells us, be strong. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor. We know the scripture. Romans 8:28 says, for we know that all things work together for good for those who are called, that who love God and those who are called according to his purpose. God's out for my good. How about you? Are you out? Do you know God's out for your good? What do we have to do? We have to take off the mask, as I said last week. We have to take off the mask, as I said last week. Take off that mask. Take off that mask and begin to believe God for healing. Amen? What can be produced in our lives if we allow the river to heal? What can be produced in our lives? Do you know the Bible says there's a river that flows from the throne? It goes out, it overflows its banks. I'm going to read that passage in a minute, but everywhere the river goes, what's it do? Everywhere the river goes, what's it do? Everywhere the river goes, it heals and brings life. Our desire should be, God, enlarge our territory. In 1 Chronicles 4:9 and 10, Jabez's prayer was about he wanted to be more honorable than his brothers, and his mother called his name Jabez, saying, because I bore him in pain. And Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, that your hand would be with me and that you would keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain. So God granted him his request. I want to tell you something. Listen, Bethesda, we've talked about this so many times, but I believe it's true, and we're going to keep rehearsing it. Bethesda is about to explode. Now, I'm not talking about exploding and vanishing. I'm talking about exploding. But I want to know out of you, what could be if we cast off all chains and we allowed Holy Spirit to break down every wall? And we stop paying more attention to the eternal things in our lives that the enemy has twisted, and we let God heal us and deliver us. What could we do for the kingdom? What if you let your gifts and talents be used, not just for your profit, but for the kingdom? Huh? What would we do? What would we do for God if we were standing in the liberty of Christ? He says, stand therefore in the liberty that Christ has given to you for freedom. What could we do? Let's think about this. We have people here that have gifts and talents. What if we offered out here as an outreach? What if we offered as an outreach self-defense classes? Let's think outside the box. Well, you know, Pastor Jared, you're wanting us to teach people how to beat up other people. No, I'm just talking about helping people to have a little self-defense. How many of you know sometimes you might need a little bit of self-defense? Huh? You might come, try to break into my car and kill me, and I might have to self-defense myself. Yes, I know I said it that way. Hey, survival classes. Reaching out to people, helping them to learn how to survive in hard times. Now, what are you going to ultimately try to teach them? We're going to survive only one way. You can't put back enough food to last you for a famine. You might put back some food and some water to help you get through some inflation. But you ain't going to endure through the whole thing. You can't put that much. You don't have a big enough place to put that much food. So ultimately, we're going to teach people to survive. You need Jesus. How about archery and shooting? We got people here who like to blow stuff up and like to shoot. Do you think people might just be interested in maybe some of that stuff? What about cooking classes? Janelle, James, Sarita, you could teach how to make chicken and dumplings, and you would teach and instruct them to make it more than once a year. Trying to throw some humor in there so it don't seem like you've been sitting so long. Not working, is it? Recovery groups. What if you got out of yourself and started pouring into others? What if you got out of your own junk that the devil's got you wrapped up, tangled up, tied up in, and you started sowing into some of these folks that are coming here from Recovery Works and from House of Hope? One of the guys that was in the altar today praying that Richard came over and prayed for was from across the street in a House of Hope. Man, isn't that what we say this is? The House of Mercy, the House of Hope. What if you started spending some time with them, giving them something besides a few programs? What if you didn't tell them all the time about 12 steps to sobriety? Why don't you teach them the 12 steps to getting a hold of Jesus, the author and the finisher of their faith? Premarital and marital classes. All of you folks that think you're supposed to be ministering to marriages, what are you doing? And then I thought about this, Gina. I thought about this, Gina. What about, have you guys gone to a restaurant here lately? Have you noticed that most of the people that wait on you, even if they're not even in the Mexican restaurant, can't hardly speak English? You're telling them, hey, I'd like to have this, and they're looking at you like you're deer in the headlights. This. Huh? What about us taking our gift and offering English classes? Man, before long, before long, Bethesda would have a Spanish church meeting here on Sunday nights, preaching the gospel to all the Hispanics and all the illegal aliens that are coming into our country. Oh, Pastor Jerry, I ain't going to help no illegal alien. Man, if you introduce them to Jesus and they get thrown out, they'll evangelize where they came from. We're not telling them it's okay that you broke the law to get here. We're just trying to teach them about Jesus before they get thrown out. When Trump gets to be president again, he's going to export them all. Let's get them first. So that we're sowing seed. What a fast way, man, for evangelism to take place. Man, let's just get all the undocumented that can't speak English. Let's teach them English. That's what they're going to think we're doing. When really we're going to teach them Jesus, and we're going to sow seed into the nations. I know you guys think I'm awful, but I'm telling you, it's time for Bethesda to get off our hands. It's time for us to realize that what we're called to do is to win the lost. We're called to sow water. We're called to go out and harvest. Did you hear me? We're called to go out and harvest. I got just a couple more little scriptures. I'm sorry. I'm not really, but I just want to say it. Make myself sound halfway decent. I thought I had them. Maybe I don't have them. Oh, yes, here it is. Isaiah 6 and 8, he says this. Isaiah does. He's going through this thing of, in the year King Uzziah died, he saw the Lord high and lifted up, and he falls on his face, and he cries out, I'm a man of unclean lips. I live in the midst of a people. What was it? He was affected, inflicted, and tormented. A prophet of God. Did you hear me? A prophet of God, not some heathen dog. He said, man, I am in the midst of a people of unclean lips. I've got unclean lips. And he cried out to the Lord, and the Lord had an angel take the tongs and take the coals off of the altar and put them on Isaiah's mouth and cleansed him. And then when he was cleansed, listen, when you get set free today, when you get cleansed, this is what you're going to say. And I heard the voice of the Lord. Yeah. How many want to hear the voice of the Lord? I can't believe I almost forgot this. How many of you want to hear the voice of the Lord? Do you want to hear the voice of the Lord? Do you want to hear the voice of the Lord? He said, and I heard, I was cleansed, I was delivered, and I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? Who will go for us? Then I said, here I am, Lord. Send me. Here I am, Lord. Here I am, Lord. Send me. Matthew 9:37-38. Jesus said to his disciples, he said this, the harvest truly is plentiful. The harvest truly is plentiful. The harvest truly is plentiful. Jesus didn't say the problem was the harvest. The harvest is plentiful. Listen. Look out there. The harvest is plentiful. Here's what he says, though. But the laborers are few. But he didn't stop. He said, therefore pray, the Lord of the harvest will provide laborers. I want the prayer, intercessory prayer team to come. We're going to do something. I don't know if I've ever done this at Bethesda or not, but I've been here so long, I can't remember every time. And I'd like for the elders to come as well, their wives, if they're in here, and they can. And what we're going to do is you're going to make a line down the hall, down the aisle on both sides. Don't worry about who's first, who's last. Just get in line. The scripture that I was going to read is found in Ezekiel 47. And it says that Ezekiel saw this vision, saw the throne room, saw the things of God. And he said that there was this river that flowed from the throne of God. And he said, I saw a man with a line in his hand. And the man measured out 1,000 cubits. And the water was to the knees. And he said, I saw the man measure 1,000 cubits. And the water was to the loins. I saw the man measure 1,000 cubits. And the water was deep, a water that you could not touch the bottom. It was a water that needed to be swam in. To me, and I'm sure there's more meaning to this than what I'm talking about here, but to me, the ankles, I'm still in control. The knees, I'm still in control. The loins, I'm still in control. But when you get into the water that you have to swim in, you are no longer. You can be susceptible to the current. You can be susceptible to anything. You cannot touch the bottom. If you cannot swim, you will drown. I believe that's where God wants us. But I like this because he says, and the water overflowed its banks. Man, I want water that overflows my banks. Out of your belly shall flow rivers of water. That's why it's important, because listen, wherever that water from that river in Ezekiel went, everywhere it went, it healed. Everywhere that it went, it brought life. The water that will overtake us, the water to swim in, the water that flows out of us should be flowing on all those around us and healing them and causing life. But we've bottled it up, believing the lies of the enemy. And we bounce around through life and struggles and battles, thinking that that's just the way it is. And we're living below our privileges as a child of the King because we are allowing the entanglements and the traps and the walls of the enemy to keep us down. Well, if you're in this place today and you want freedom, you want the walls to be broken off and down. You want the prison door opened. And you want life. You want to live. Not that you want to live for yourself, but you want to live so that others can live. Huh? Men, you ought to want to live because you want your wife to live. You ought to want to live because you want your kids to live. You shouldn't be wallowing around in self-pity and lukewarmness and mediocrity while your family suffers and starves to death. Get up off your seat and say, God, deliver me. If you're in this place this morning and you want to be free, I believe this morning, they're going to put some music on. I believe this morning the Lord's going to set whosoever will. Listen, I believe lots of people are getting ready to get up. You don't have to move out of your seat. How many of you know God's arm's long enough? Yeah,
I know you're all amen to me because you think I'm going to tell you it's okay for you to sit there because God's arm is long enough. But I'm going to tell you what, God's arm is long enough. But sometimes we got to move. Sometimes when we sit, we just sit there and we don't respond, we don't come forward. We sit there and what are we telling the enemy? Ah, I got this. Yeah, I'm telling you right now in the name of Jesus, we don't have this. We're floundering. I'm going to tell you right now, Bethesda right now, since we don't have the new addition built, we should be having to have two or three services right now. With all the talent, with all the gifts, with all the people that we have in this church, if we were going out doing what we were doing, if we're free, you shouldn't be able to hold the people that would come in this place. I was at a seminar this week. A mother church planted a daughter church. The daughter church, from the time of its inception, is now 9 months old. They average in 9 months 280 people. This church has been in Elizabethtown, Kentucky since 1940s. They have been at this location since the 90s on a main drag road that hundreds and thousands of cars go by every single day. And we struggle to hold on to 120 or so people. I'm going to tell you something. The reason is that because we're walking in bondage. We're walking with the walls up, and we are also not going out and using our talents and gifts to tell people the kingdom of God is at hand. No mas. No more. We're taking back what the enemy has stolen from us. We're going into the enemy's camp. We're not waiting for him to come here like we have been doing. We're going into his camp, and we're going to take back what he has stolen from us, our families, our neighbors, our city, our neighborhoods. And we're going to proclaim everywhere we go, the kingdom of God is at hand. How many of you want to see God use you mightily? How many want to be free? All you got to do right now is by faith. By faith. You're not going to get up and go, well, here I go again. I'm going to go through this altar type thing. I'm going to go up here and I'm going to pray and I'm going to leave here. Same old mess I was when I got here. You're going to get up by faith. You're going to see yourself coming through this line right here, being prayed for and ministered to by people who have been preparing themselves, people who love you, people who want to see you free. You're going to be prayed for. The Holy Spirit is going to touch your life. And in faith, all the shackles and the wall is going to fall off in the river, because everywhere the river goes and whoever the river touches lives. Is that you today? Is that what you're after? Right now, I don't know why you're waiting on me. I'm just yakking. You can start trickling out. You can start doing what's God speaking to you that way. That way. From Pastor Fred and them first. That way. Make your beeline over to that walkthrough. Put some music on, please. Everybody in here that wants to have the chains broken off. Loose us, God, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus.